Hey, all you Days fans, look who's joining us live in the studio. It's Mr. James Reynolds, aka Abe Carver. Stay tuned.
You're tuning into the destination for TV super fan discussion, AfterBuzz TV. And now, let the buzz begin.
Why, hello, all of you Days of Our Lives fans. Welcome to AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On, and we have the pleasure of joining us today in our studio, the one and only Mr. James Reynolds.
Thank you so
How
much.
How are you, sir?
I'm wonderful. I feel great.
You good. Made it it's in the rain.
Oh, my God.
I've not only made it in the rain, but I'm just so... I'm thrilled to be here. I can't tell you. This
We're thrilled to have
We're
you.
We're thrilled to have you. And, of course, you guys know me. I'm Tony Moore. And, of course, my wonderful, talented... handsome, extraordinaire host.
Wow.
He makes me say all of those things.
I make,
my goodness.
It's in my contract.
Yeah. Wow.
Matthew
is there,
Evan
is there
Paine.
Money being exchanged here? Is there
we'll talk about that
on?
After the show.
Although I agree with every one of those.
Oh, thank you.
I get paid in pizza rolls. That's how I get paid.
Oh, yes.
I get paid in pizza rolls.
Good. I want you
Enjoy.
One. Yet. I want you one. I'll be spitting it out at everybody. So.
Well, of course, we are going to... take a walk down memory lane with James and talk about life before, after, and during Days. So buckle up, you all who are watching live. Thank you so much for joining us. And if you haven't already, make sure you like us, follow us on all social media platforms. We are Dish and Days on Facebook and Instagram and @_DishandDays on Twitter. The at is usually implied.
Yes. Let's just jump right in.
Yeah,
let's
dive right in.
Oskaloosa, like Kansas.
Oskaloosa, you said it right.
Oh.
Good for you.
Thank you.
Good for you. I mean, I can't tell you how often people will say all sorts of other things other than Oskaloosa.
Everything but.
Yes, everything but Oskaloosa. And that's great. Good for you.
Thank you. Tony was telling me that it was a town of, what, about 1,000?
About 1,000 people.
Yeah.
Oskaloosa is county seat of Jefferson County. And I'm there a lot. Good friends still there. On our home that's been in our family for 150 years in Oskaloosa. And I'm very attached to the state of Kansas. I still serve on the... board of directors of the State Historical Society, and it's wonderful growing up in this little small farm town.
My high school had more people than your entire town.
I am not surprised at all. I had 27 people in my high school class.
My
105 wow. in the high school completely. So that was that included farm kids. So that wasn't like it was. Part of the population of this town that were also kids that came in from the farms. I've got a very good friend to this day that went to a one-room schoolhouse.
Oh.
In fact, I think one of the last one-room schoolhouses probably ever.
Yeah.
Mind-blowing.
Yeah, it is.
What was life like? Because I just imagine a very quiet, small, town, but so many people came from, we had President Dwight Eisenhower.
Yes, from the state of Kansas.
You.
Yes.
I almost feel like...
The president, the mayor.
The president,
right.
the mayor.
It's almost like, which, listen,
yeah,
if you're going
sure
to if you're gonna be great, you come from Kansas. I feel like I
well,
should
Kansas,
start over.
Yeah, there are a lot of really wonderful people from the state of Kansas. And, I do feel fortunate to be from there. I think there are a lot of things that... have helped me through life, and the fact that I not only started in the state of Kansas, but grew up in a small town, and the people that surrounded me in that town who became supportive, and the most important of which was my mother, who worked extraordinarily hard for me and my brother to get through life. But yeah, there are things that small towns give you. I think there's things that every town gives you, but specifically small towns. And maybe the biggest of that is a certain sense of independence. Because even though you have people around you and people always know what you're doing, there's you. When you go out in the big world, there's you.
Can't get away with anything in the small town.
No.
Everyone knows.
Well, you can't get away with anything. That's for
period.
Sure. That's for sure.
Everyone knows.
Yeah, that's for sure.
My parents grew up in a small town in Alabama called Salem. literally
Salem. Do you know about a town called Salem?
Like near Opelika?
maybe not so much close to there, but yeah. But
you know about
I know about Salem.
I am like shocked.
A thing or two.
I'm shocked because whenever I say Salem, people go Selma. I'm like, no, Salem is like right near Opelika. Yeah. It's like 30 minutes outside of Opelika, and you literally blink.
Opelika.
Yes.
I bet people don't get that right up very often.
They
either.
Don't. They say Opelika.
Yeah.
That's the only one I've heard of, but it's, but it's really a small town. And
Appalachia. Appalachia.
You know, Appalachia. Yeah. But whenever we go back, because I didn't grow up there. My dad was in the military, so I've traveled ever since I was born. But anytime I go back, it's, you just know that, A, you're surrounded by family, you're surrounded by people who know family, and if you did anything, it's like everyone had permission to discipline you.
Yeah.
So, like, if you cut up in school, then there was some distant relatives or a friend that could, like, put you in check and then tell your parents about it.
On the other hand, there's a real sense of freedom. I mean, we went out the door in the morning, and we didn't come back in the house until the sun was down.
Right.
And so you have all those eyes on you all the time, which I think in thinking about it now, is a certain sense of security as well as a certain sense of people looking at you. but it was also a sense of freedom. I mean, we were we were out and we were about and we did things. We went into people's houses. Nobody. Mm-hmm. My mother never locked her door. Her entire life, she never locked the front door.
Wow.
Ever.
I mean, you have to nowadays.
Well, you have to no matter where you are. Yeah. And my brother lives in that home now. Mm-hmm. And you have to no matter where you are. But that sense that you had that freedom and that security was something that we just kind of took for granted. That's just the way the world was. You know, the first time as an adult, I went to New York and started to say hello to people on the street. Mm-hmm. People looked at me really funny. But I was used to that. I'm like, oh, hey, what's going on? Hey, you know,
well,
I got tired
changed.
Of it pretty quick,
right.
too. But there are a lot of people to say hi to. But
And not much has changed. Even here, when I say hello to people, they're like, you're not from here, are you? And I'm like, no, I'm from South Carolina.
Yeah.
It's what we do in the South. We're always just like, hello, hi.
Hello, yeah, how are you?
Hello, yeah. How are you? Yeah, yeah.
When
yeah.
you ask how are you, you mean it. You actually would
actually,
like
yeah.
to know.
Yeah, you actually mean
you don't
it.
Mind.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a good thing. It's a good thing. It's a conversation starter and a good thing. And I still do that. I still say hello to people. It's fun.
Well, speaking of the military and armed forces, you went into the Marines.
I did.
Right after you graduated high school.
Yeah.
What did you take from your experience in the Marines that you still hold on to now?
Well, it's a good question. It's a really good question because I think when you go in so young, I was 17, and I had actually been in and been out and completed that 3 years before I was 21. So, you know, what you learn a lot, but it doesn't necessarily become evident, at least in my case, and everybody is individual. It doesn't become evident right away what you learn. But, man, a lot of those things are just enhancing what you've already known. Mm-hmm. You know, I knew how to work. I knew how to push through pain. I knew how, you know, I knew that effort was going to be rewarded in some positive way if I kept at it. All of those things are what you figure out. But I think also there's a sense of pushing past your initial, and I want to. I'm going to say the word fear, but I don't mean that.
Yeah.
I mean a certain uncertainty, and you always push past that uncertainty. You always find a way of going past that uncertainty. You have it.
Push through it.
And you embrace it, but you push through it.
Yeah. And then after that, after you completed that, you went to school for pre-law and journalism.
Yeah.
I'm a journalism major too. So, Winthrop in Rock Hill, South Carolina.
Yeah.
But you also, I mean, before you went and studied journalism, you were reporting and worked and did that in the Marines.
I did. I was lied to by my Marine recruiter. I know that might surprise you, and please forgive me, Marines, but it's true.
They're watching right now,
and it's true. And I'm sure that is not the case. Mm-hmm. And maybe it was just an exaggeration. But I wanted to be a writer. I grew up kind of wanting to be a writer, and had these grand ideas of what I would accomplish how to write. Yeah. I also was fascinated with history and
English, right?
And English and loved and wanted to be a Marine. Yeah. So when I did eventually realize that maybe college wasn't my right at the age of 17 wasn't the place I should go. Mm-hmm. I told the recruiter, I said, you know, I want to be a writer. He said, oh, you can do it in the Marine Corps. turned out he was right.
Yes.
A lot of times.
He said, you can do it. It turns out, just by chance, when I went in, they had the MOS, which I still remember today, mm-hmm. 4312. They were taking tests for people to enter information services. I got a score that was more than adequate to enter that MOS, and I was assigned to become a journalist, mm-hmm. Which was maybe the most wonderful thing that ever happened to me, because it meant that I was a quiet kid. I was very quiet, very shy,
but very involved. Correct.
Very involved, but I could observe. I didn't have to always participate as. Mm-hmm. As a journalist, and the Marine Corps taught me how Hemingway, and believe me, I'm not comparing myself to Hemingway at all, mm-hmm. once said, he worked for the Kansas City Star, which is a paper very close to near where I live, mm-hmm. and he said that his experience at the Kansas City Star taught him to write a compound sentence, and the Marine Corps taught me to write a picture caption. And I learned to write a picture caption, and that... that kind of solidified my desire to be a writer, and I realized, and I wrote a lot more than that as time went on.
Yeah.
And that experience was invaluable. And my years, my first assignment was in Hawaii, which could not be better.
I was born there.
Yeah. Oh, you were?
Yeah.
Oh, my
yeah.
goodness. Just like Obama.
So yeah. Yeah.
Just like
our
Obama.
Next president of the United
yes.
States, ladies.
Can you imagine? Yep. I think my first order of business would be days would never be canceled.
Good. I would hope. I would hope that's the case. We'll look for 4 years from now.
Yeah.
And I loved being a journalist. I mm-hmm. loved writing.
Yeah.
And the only thing that co-opted me that after I got home, after I got home, I went to college. And then mm-hmm. I thought, maybe I better go to college because maybe nobody's going to hire me. Just this, I'm going to go to college. And I wanted to. And the GI Bill, thankfully, me as well as millions of others, moved us along. Yeah. And a very good friend of mine, a man named Howard Renslan, who lives in Connecticut now and is a wonderful actor, mm-hmm. We met, and he said we were having a discussion about where to meet girls. And he said the theater department is the place to do that. And so I said, okay, well, I'll go with you to your audition.
Yeah,
I did. I got cast in a play, and I'm with you now.
And here you are.
But here I am.
Do you remember that play, your first play?
I did, Mad Woman of Shiloh. I played the sergeant in Mad Woman of Shiloh. I got cast, and
who knew that
it was wonderful.
That role as a sergeant would eventually lead you to playing. As well, did you start off as a sergeant?
I did. I started off as a sergeant.
That's like the
sort of full circle in a way. In a way, I played a few sergeants along the way, but. Yeah, Detective Sergeant Abe Carver was when I came on, and but anyway, that was it. I kind of fell in love, and I've often described it as kismet. It was that moment, and I thought, oh, maybe you know, maybe this might be more important to me mm-hmm. than my writing career, and also the whole thing. And I did write. I actually did write professionally. I wrote for some newspapers and magazines, and mm-hmm. So I did actually actually write it. I wasn't just talking about it. I actually did become a writer, and that was a good thing. But I never did grow fond of deadlines.
No one ever does.
We have something in common.
No one ever does. I feel like it creatively, it stifles you because, you know, what if by then you don't have that? But the day after, like, everything just kind of comes
together. Well, everything, exactly. For a while, I did, I was an arts critic for a bit of time. Mm-hmm. And that was one of the issues that I realized, because you had that deadline at the end of the night, so you had to go to a play or a concert or a dance or something. Mm-hmm. And then you literally had to go in the office. Now it could be done online.
Yeah.
But you had to go in the office, had to type up the story, do it, think about it, make it as complete as possible. You know, I'd taken notes and all of that. Make it as complete as possible. And then that was it. And then I'd go to bed and then I'd wake up the next morning and go, oh, you know what? I missed this thing that happened in the second act. And I should have talked about that.
Yeah. I used to feel like that too. I'm like, ooh, forgot to put that in there.
Yeah.
Looks.
Yeah.
I was like, oh well.
So now, how long did you work as a journalist?
I went to school for it, but I didn't apply it. Like I was more news reporter, like on camera.
Oh, right.
And so I learned how to report and how to, you know, edit videos and things like that. But then I realized that I didn't want to report on like car crashes or car chases or anything like that. I wanted to be an entertainment reporter. I found it more fascinating to find out what Britney Spears was doing rather than who got killed on the 405. So I kind of went that route, but it helped me with my web show that I have now.
Well, that's great.
So I applied it still, but writing was never my forte. I'm great at talking.
Well, I actually wanted to be ultimately my goal down the road was to be a political commentator. You know, work for the New York Times and Washington Post, and sit up and pontificate.
Well, see, now you can start your own podcast now.
I could. Yeah,
you could do
possible.
That.
I may have to talk to you guys.
Yeah.
And people will tune in.
Yeah.
Lounging with James and Tony.
Yeah. I'm up for that. Let's talk about that.
We can do
we
it.
We got that.
We can do it.
I would good. Tune in. That would be a great show. So you wrapped up things at the university.
Yes.
And then what was your next step to becoming an actor?
Well, I sort of kind of wrapped up things. I left. And
that's a wrap, folks.
There was no wrapping up things.
That works.
Like, you know, I'm just going to go.
That works. It was a great university. I loved it and I still love them to this day. But what happened was, once again, I'd become an actor.
Yeah.
And once that gets in your blood, it's like this, you know, tremendous drug that you suddenly start taking. You go, oh man, this is really cool. I don't want to stop this stuff. Mm-hmm. And I'd become an actor. So I began that journey, that odyssey of being an actor. And I traveled to different cities. I ran, I was asked to run a theater mm-hmm. at one point, and ran, not only was I an actor, but I also was an artistic director and theater manager, mm-hmm. And then I began that entire journey. My friend and I, who mentioned Harry Howard, we went to New York for a while, and we, I did a lot of the regional theaters around the country, mm-hmm. and then found myself actually in Colorado doing regional theater and running a theater. And I did the first movie and commercial that I had done. I was a little bit of a theater snob. Mm-hmm. I didn't really want to do film and
TV.
Yeah, not, you know, I'd say snob, but it wasn't for any reason other than I was comfortable.
That's right.
I was happy. Yeah. That was all.
I think there was a time where it was like that, where theater people strictly did theater, and then you had your film and TV people, and the two never really crossed.
Right.
Because everyone kind of looked at it as like,
exactly. I don't want to do that.
Yeah.
But it was a little bit less of that than I was fine.
Yeah.
You know, life was good. Yeah. It was not a big issue. But then finally I did a film actually called Mr. Majowski. I met a number of people and said, yeah, you gotta come to L.A. And I've been in New York. Mm-hmm. New York was good. But they said, you got to do that. And I did. And virtually started working pretty much the minute I got to L.A. So
yeah.
You started working or started booking?
Well,
did you start booking
both.
Pretty
I booked
quickly?
And worked.
Wow, which isn't well nowadays. Yeah. It's not. It doesn't happen.
It doesn't,
that easily.
Trust
for
me.
People
I don't
no,
know.
No, 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 no. I don't think it's ever been easy. I don't think it's ever been easy. And Charlie Shaughnessy, I remember once saying that we should all be very grateful, those of us who have been able to access that little bit of fairy dust that's sprinkled on us that helps us to move through, because I have very, very close, extraordinarily talented friends who have not been had not had those opportunities.
Right.
It literally comes down to opportunities. That's all it comes down to, is opportunities, because there's so many wonderful actors and writers and directors and people that populate this town.
Yes.
And New York and in London and Vancouver and all these places.
Yeah.
That it just comes down to those of us who are fortunate enough to be in a room at the right time.
Yeah.
And so I will always be grateful for whatever that is. Mm-hmm. And no one should ever pretend to know the secret.
Right.
Yeah.
That was almost a question, if there was a recipe for success or advice for young actors to make it.
Well, there's no advice to make it. Mm-hmm. There the only advice is to love it and to work hard at it and then see what happens.
Yeah.
That's really all you can do. You can love it and work hard at it. I will tell you, I've had the good fortune of talking to a lot of young actors, particularly universities and different places, and I will tell you that if you don't love it, if you can't really go out and work every day at it in one way or another, it doesn't mean you gotta, sit there and grind 7 days a week, but it means that's gotta be your primary focus for whatever period that is, then you really need to find something else and to do, because it does take that. But I know a lot of people who just have not had that good fortune, who work extraordinarily hard at it and are constantly doing it. So, those of us who've been fortunate enough to have good, long, successful careers should always let everyone else know that there's nothing special about us other than we've been in that right room at the right time, or those right rooms at the right time.
And you've definitely had a very long and extensive career, not only with Days, but you've booked a lot of guest star and co-star roles.
Yeah, I've been very fortunate. Yeah.
I saw one actually very recently. You played the principal on 227. And
I did. Yeah,
I remember, because they always do like mini marathons now. Okay. And I was watching it because
227 brings a smile to everybody's face when they hear
does.
About it.
Yeah. I mean,
it was
Jackie
wonderful.
Harry and Marla Gibbs.
And
then
let's remember Regina King.
Yes.
Who is a major force and a great talent.
Yes.
And I understand just signed with ABC to develop her own shows, or maybe perhaps not her own, but to produce shows.
Yeah,
and 227 was very important.
Yeah, and I was tickled because I was like, "That's James." It's like I didn't know he did 227.
Oh yeah,
and there you are popping up.
I think I
put it on my Instagram. I'm pretty sure I did.
Well, we all have those of us who've been around for a day or two. We all have resumes. We've all done a lot of things, and as I say, it's a process. It's a process. You've got to work at it and work at it and work at it and work at it. And that's what happens.
I made a note of some other shows that you've appeared in that made me smile, just because it's a beautiful resume. Seinfeld, Magnum PI, Heart to Heart, Dukes of Hazzard, Different Strokes, and The Incredible Hulk, just to name a few.
Yeah.
Any favorites? Any amazing stories? a couple, maybe.
That they I'm willing to share with. Yeah, there's some pretty extraordinary stories. Actually, I'm probably not going to share those with you, but you know, there are lots of them. You know, I guess one. I was thinking about this today. I'm a big podcast fan. Mm-hmm. Here you guys, and. There is a podcast, a history podcast. I love history. Mm-hmm. And they're just doing a series on Vincent Price. And one of my favorites was a series I had actually just before I did Days of Our Lives and almost kept me from doing Days of Our Lives, to be mm-hmm. truthful.
Oh, wow.
Called Time Express. And mm-hmm. it was the only series that Vincent Price ever did. Mm-hmm. And he was the star of the show. And I ended up being a co-star on that show. So that's and believe me, there are a lot of other highlights, but that's one because he's so iconic in American film history, mm-hmm. and he was such a wonderful man, mm-hmm. Just an extraordinary man. And in the time we had together, which you know wasn't a tremendous amount of time, 4 or 5 months, it was lovely. It was just lovely. It's the only way I can describe it. So that stands out. But there's so many others that are really wonderful and special.
Was there ever a show that you were booked on that you had been a fan of already before getting the booking and thought of?
There many that you talked about and others that you didn't talk about. That's always kind of that's always pretty fun.
Yeah.
You never know. You know, people can tell you, and I know I have a lot of friends who are what they call in quotes working actors, and mm-hmm. and so they're always going on a different show, and they're doing that. And so they're always walking onto a set of a show that they watched or they liked,
right?
Or that kind of thing. And I think as actors, we have that advantage of both being fans and co-workers.
Yes, mm-hmm. I feel like when Jen Lilly was here for the Days event, she had just appeared on Grey's Anatomy, and she mm-hmm. said, "I couldn't believe I was on Grey's Anatomy, yeah. a show that I watch and love."
Yeah.
It's terrific. Yeah. How exciting!
Yeah, isn't that great?
Yes,
isn't that great?
Yeah.
And we've had people on our show who you know were fans of the show before they came on the show,
yeah.
and people that have been who are now you would think of as members of the Days of Our Lives rep company.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. But when they started 20 years ago or 10 years ago or whenever it was, they were fans of the show. They
yeah.
watched the show.
There's something magical about L.A.
There is.
Yeah.
There is. Actually is. I mean, yeah. L.A. is really a pretty special place. Are you from here?
I'm from Boston.
Oh, wow. Well, see, all three of us are from...
From somewhere else.
Somewhere else. And, you know, although there are a lot of people, obviously now more than before who were born in LA and come here. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to talent, and I've said this frequently, we have a theater now, and we are always casting people. And I believe this when it comes to acting talent, but I also think with writers and directors. You just go through the list of whatever you need talent for, mm-hmm. Painters, but this is the Saudi Arabia of talent mm-hmm. in many ways.
Yeah.
And you can find what you want.
Oh, yeah. I've been in situations where people have asked for some crazy, interesting things, and we could find it.
Yeah, just drill down a little bit, and mm-hmm. right under that soil is a gusher of talent, shoots up.
Yeah. Well, speaking of Days, you have been on the show and originated the character of Abe Carver since 1981. Mm-hmm. For you, looking back on your time on Days, how does that make you feel to be still... you know, in this position of your character and being the person that originated and no one else has played Abe Carver since you came?
Isn't that extraordinary?
Yeah.
That is extraordinary. Yeah. That's remarkable.
Well, it makes me feel honored mm-hmm. To begin with. I feel very honored by that. I feel very honored that Abe has been accepted into the homes of so many people for so many years.
Yeah.
And continues to be someone that people want in their homes.
Mm-hmm.
And so So I absolutely feel honored by that. There are just so many. I mean, this is not something that when you're 12 years old, you think, oh, guess what?
Yeah.
Guess what I'm going to do?
There's no way you could have known.
You have no idea. You have no idea. And so, you know, the fact that I am a part of this iconic television show, this iconic piece of art, mm-hmm. American art, mm-hmm. that is now in the Smithsonian, as a matter of fact, to me is a tremendous honor. Mm-hmm. And, I do have, as immodest as it may sound, some pride in the fact of being a piece of this.
Yeah.
A piece of this great history.
Do fans call you Abe when they walk by you?
A lot of fans call me Abe. A lot of fans call me Abe. A good number will say James, which I'm always happy about. But yes, of course, you know, they know me as Abe Carver.
Yes.
Of course.
Yeah.
Do you remember your first day on Days and how you felt going into this genre of soaps?
Yeah. Well, I had never done soap.
Yeah.
It wasn't something. I had actually gotten an offer from a couple of soaps just before the Days offer came in.
Mm-hmm.
And when the Days came in, I was surprised,
mm-hmm.
Actually, because I had been told. In fact, I had wrapped the Time Express show on CBS with Vincent Price not too long before then.
Mm-hmm.
So I was kind of looking to move into another nighttime show or some other things.
Yeah.
But then there was another offer for soap, mm-hmm. and that I thought was pretty interesting. And Days, I had been told, was I knew this role had been out there, but I was told it was off the table. That it wasn't
right.
It wasn't going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I thought, okay, well, that's the way that goes.
Mm-hmm.
And and then suddenly there was like a little bit of flurry of activity, and I got called in.
Mm-hmm.
And read for the role, and literally was called in the next day to read for the network, and then was asked if I could remember lines. I remember that specific amazing call, and said, they want to know if you can remember lines really fast. And I said, well, yeah.
I mean,
sure.
Yeah,
whatever
sure.
you need.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, I'm an
I've
actor,
never been challenged on that. I've never been, because I've never done daytime, so I've never been actually challenged on that, but I never had an issue. And so I actually got the call. This all started in, this was like 1 week, and they had seen, they had seen a lot of actors,
mm-hmm.
a lot of actors in between. But I, from the time I read till the time I got the call that I got the role, about 3 days passed.
Oh,
and,
wow.
And then I actually was supposed to start the following Monday, and I remember my doorbell ringing, and I walked out to the door, and I had this stack of scripts that was, you know, almost came up to my knee.
Yeah.
Going, what is?
Oh God!
Did you think like, oh, what did I get myself into?
What is going on here? I was excited. I was very. I thought, well, this is cool. This is very cool. But I think like a lot of people, I thought I was very grateful and very, very happy. Didn't honestly know a lot about the show. I think, like with most of America, I knew Matt Carey's voice.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I knew the Hourglass.
Mm-hmm.
And that was in my head. And I thought, well, this is going to be cool. And those scripts were wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
They were just fantastic. Those scripts were great. And I thought, wow, this is going to, however long this lasts, this is going to be really fun to do.
When you were auditioning over the course of those 3 days, did you have a good feeling that it was yours, or were you completely clueless?
I was clueless because it wasn't mine. It wasn't mine, and so I went in knowing that it wasn't mine, and I went in knowing that there was a good possibility that I was only being seen out of some kind of courtesy.
Mm-hmm.
And so I knew that, and when I did go in and met the network and the producers, the room was packed.
That was my next question. Right, how many people are involved when you read for the network?
A lot.
Yeah.
As it always is. You know, I've been through that experience many times. And it's always packed with people. And you sometimes you know some of them. Sometimes you know two of them. This one, I knew none of them.
Wow. Nerve-wracking.
It was... Yeah, it was and it wasn't. I think because I was, you know, I pretty much knew that I was an afterthought, so it wasn't as much nerve-wracking as, you know, I just wanted to do this. I was actually going to take the other, I thought about, I was pretty close to saying yes to the other offer, so. Mm.
What changed your mind?
It was Days of Our Lives.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was Days of Our Lives. I didn't know about daytime, and I was not sure of it, but I knew about Days of Our Lives. And I just thought this is, and I talked to people, and I realized this is very cool.
Yeah.
This is pretty cool. I think maybe I should, as long as I can hold off and take some time and,
yeah,
this is what I should do.
And you've been doing it. I mean, Abe has had some very interesting storylines throughout your time there. Yeah. And one, and I definitely feel like we should touch on, because your character, of course, as soon as he was brought on, was on the hunt for Stefano, as everyone
always.
As everyone always is.
Always,
and,
yes.
You know, unfortunately, we lost... Joe Muscolo.
Yes.
What, from yes. from your perspective, because I'm pretty sure you had to work with him a lot, you know, over the years.
A lot.
What was your experience of, like, working with him and fondest memories?
Well, working with Joe is one of my fondest memories of the show. You know.
You were looking for him a lot, so of course.
I was looking for him a lot. He was my father-in-law.
Yeah.
He was my father-in-law.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Joe Stefano was very important as far as Abe was concerned, mm-hmm. and as far as I was concerned. And every scene I had with Joe was a scene, and I don't think it's you know, I don't think I'm speaking out of school saying it's a scene we both look forward to. We both talked about that. We both talked about doing scenes together and how much we enjoyed doing scenes together. Mm-hmm. And I felt as if those scenes were always elevated to a certain degree. And, you know, I hope we bring that intensity to every scene, but I do know with Joe, it was always a little bit of a different kind of challenge. Mm-hmm. And he had a presence that few people have.
Yeah.
And you want to meet that. Mm-hmm. You want to go for that. And that was pure joy. Every scene I had with Joe was joy.
Yeah.
It was purely joy. And we had a tremendous respect for each other. We had a great agreement on where the scenes were and where they should go. Mm-hmm. We had fun. We had fun.
I love when the storyline did take a turn that Lexi was in fact Stefano's
daughter. Right.
And I love the time period where Lexi, Renee Jones,
yes.
Where she kind of, you know, took the Demare name and,
yes.
and took it under her wing, and she became a little evil.
She became a little Demare.
A little Demare. And I love that.
Which is a good name for a song, don't you think?
Yeah.
I'm a little Demare.
I'm a little Demare. Yeah. I still remember, I don't remember, like, where everyone was. I just remember her in this red dress with this collar.
The cowl.
Yes.
Oh my God, yes.
And
yeah.
I was like, if she is not a Demare now, I mean, this look just solidified it.
Yeah.
Renee Jones is beautiful.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
Well, you talk about when, you know, the elements of a show all come together at a moment, mm-hmm. and that the way she was wardrobed at that moment sold that transition.
Yes, it really
The fact
did.
That she was in that bright red and that cowl, that collar that came out, mm-hmm. and it was just a lovely, lovely moment, and it enhanced Abe's own frustration and anger and sense of betrayal as well at that moment, at that time. This woman that he loved and felt, she felt the same way, and yet the blood that flowed through her veins seemed to have a stronger pull than his adoration of her.
And she betrayed, Lexi betrayed Abe on more than one occasion.
Yeah, well, yes, yeah,
there
she
were a
did.
Lot of ups
she
and
did.
Downs.
Some were imaginary, and some were real. And you know, the thing about Abe is he's not certainly not a pure man. He's not a man without flaws. But he's a trusting man, loyal man.
He's a good man.
Ultimately, he's loyal. Mm-hmm. That's his core. Is to be loyal to people he likes.
Yeah.
You don't have to be good for him to like you, but he's got to like you. And if he likes you, then he is completely loyal to you. And his loyalty was cast aside.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was having a conversation with my best friend, Brian, whom I was telling you about earlier. I had tuned out of Days for a couple of years, and I was...
Shame on you.
I know. Shame on me is right. I missed out. But I was catching or getting back into the groove of Days several years ago, and there was a scene with Abe and Nicole in Daniel's living room.
Yes.
And I said to Brian, I said, why are Abe and Nicole in Daniel's living room? Why is Nicole talking to Abe? And he said, everybody talks to Abe.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
Not only does everybody talk to Abe, but, you know, and Ari will tell you this. I don't know where he's been in. But anyway, we feel that Nicole might be Abe's daughter. Between the two of us, that's kind of how we play our scene.
Yes,
because her brother is.
Yeah, and her brother is Abe's son.
Yes,
is Abe's son, and certainly not if his daughter, in fact, then his daughter, in the way that he was around and helped their family, was a good father figure as opposed to her father, who was not a good man at all. Not a good man in any way.
No.
So we have always felt the two of us. And we make every attempt in the world to play our scenes as if these two people have a very, very strong connection with each other that kind of goes beyond just Abe's. You know, Abe, as people have told me in the past, and I take great pride in this, is in many ways the moral center of Salem.
Mm-hmm.
And
absolutely.
So he is that. Even though others may wear a collar or do whatever they are for confessions, Abe becomes that guy because he's not only a good person, but he's a good person that's centered in reality as well. So he might kick your ass too.
Yeah.
But he's going to listen to you and give you a hearing, and whatever he decides to do is going to be fair ultimately.
Yes.
Yeah. But the relationship with Nicole is one of those that is. Sort of underlined with more. There's more under there.
Yeah.
I love the scenes where we get to see Abe as the father figure. Well, as the father, the scenes with Kyler Pettis as Theo and Abe are beautiful, and they're always fun to watch.
Yeah.
I love Kyler.
Yeah.
I mean, he is just tremendous. I think he, and I've said this a lot, and I mean it. I think he's got the most difficult job on the show. I think he plays the line between someone who is on the spectrum as a high-functioning person with autism beautifully.
Yes.
And he does that so very, very well.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And his sincerity comes across in every single scene that we do with each other. And I love him, and I love that character, and those scenes that we have, there's an obligation from me to show how this father feels about this boy who has exceeded expectations in every way.
I just love how just blunt he is. He will just tell it like it is, won't sugarcoat
it. Zero apologies.
Yeah. Nope. He's just like, no, this is what you're doing. I especially love now his interactions with Valerie or Vanessa.
Yes.
Vanessa Williams.
Yes.
I love their interactions because I think there was a scene a couple weeks ago where he was just like, "You're lying. She's a liar," and I'm like, Tell her. Tell her.
Yeah.
It's true. Hey, no, he is so wonderful that night. And mm-hmm. I'm so happy that Vanessa is playing Valerie.
Who, yeah.
It has been, I mean, for those who don't know, mm-hmm. Valerie was Abe's original love interest.
Yeah.
Years ago, when Abe came on the show, mm-hmm. and we had the whole Salem Strangler and all those other iconic moments and days of our lives, but Valerie Grant was
the first.
And so to have this woman come back to his life at this point in both their lives, when they're older now, they're more solid in who they are, mm-hmm. and they reach out to each other is really lovely. And Vanessa's wonderful.
Yeah, I have to say, I'm enjoying that Abe has some sort of love interest mm-hmm. now, because we haven't seen anything since Lexi.
Yeah,
that's right.
The passing of Lexi. He's been a widow for a day or two.
Yeah, yeah. Although
he's ready.
Yeah. Although he's
ready. Yes.
I noticed, like, and I don't know if Dave's. We're going to go in this direction originally, and then something changed. But there were times where I felt like they tried to put Kayla and Abe together at one point. It was very brief, and then it went away.
Yeah.
Then I thought Maxine and Abe were going to do something, and then that went away. And then finally, I was like, oh, my God, finally, we have Valerie coming in. And I'm like, thank God, because it can't be Abe and Theo all the time. No. Everyone else is getting over.
Everybody else kind of moves through their...
Yeah,
their previous relationships fairly quickly.
And here's Abe still by himself.
And from Vanessa's first scenes as Valerie, the chemistry was palpable.
I agree.
Yeah, it's just great to see that in your interactions with each other.
Yeah,
and that they're not rushing it.
No, there are the subtleties that you see.
That's one of the things I enjoy about it is that. It is a relationship that has been sustained. It's a real relationship.
Yes.
It's not something that people and especially they've been around a day or two. So people they kind of feel each other out and they see where it's going and then they have their paths and they share these different things and it comes through. But Vanessa has from day one. Bought into this potential of relationship with Abe mm-hmm. as and I think the two of them together have reignited what they had years ago, and I think mm-hmm. those people who have been in those relationships mm-hmm. that they knew somebody many many years before and then suddenly that person's brought back in their life recognize how you rekindle that flame I'm very thankful that Vanessa is as skilled and as wonderful as she is. And
she's playing the history
well.
Well. One of our loyal fans, Willis Sargent, speaking of not rushing things, Willis Sargent wants to know if you would like to see Abe marry Valerie.
Well, I think that's I think that's down the road. I mean, I think one of the things about soap operas mm-hmm. and daytime dramas is that you've got to play all the aspects of the relationship. Mm-hmm. And so the longer you play tension, mm-hmm. the relationship becomes heightened.
Yes.
And it becomes heightened for the audience. You know, that's the thing. I mean, what we go through as characters on a daytime drama is something that maybe a lot of all of the people out there would walk away from it in a heartbeat. But what we go through makes it more interesting for the audience, and it makes you come to these characters and these couples more and more. So I think there's a lot of drama ahead for Abe and Valerie. I think that I hope anyway that there's a lot of drama ahead for Abe and Valerie, and that we move toward that. But you know, clearly Abe is a man who is loyal and is dedicated to commitment, mm-hmm. and I think Valerie is as well.
Yeah,
you know, we're beginning to see things in her life and
mm-hmm.
that sort of thing. But I think we have lots of story to play out.
Oh, yeah. And I cannot wait to see them play out, and I can't wait to see what Theo has to say about it.
Me too.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, indeed.
Perfect how that's all unfolding, and indeed. I just love how insecure... Is it insecurity? fear?
Oh, with Theo? No, it's not insecurity.
I think
it's
protective.
Both protective and some fear. I mean, Theo's had Abe to himself for a long, long time.
Mm-hmm.
So there is that insecurity and fear from having to share this person. But it's protective as well. It's very protective as well.
This is coming from a good place.
No matter what happens to Theo, his father will be the central person in his life.
Of course. Yeah. Now, going back to love interest and Lexi, one of the most heart-wrenching things that we had and that we saw was the death of Lexi.
Yes.
And it was, I have to say, it was so powerful and so moving, yet it was, I couldn't imagine it going any other way. It was just, it seemed very peaceful to let the character of Lexi go in that way. Mm-hmm. And just the way that the scene was, it was such an impact. For you, who had worked with Renee Jones for so long and you know, Abe and Lexi, you know, have been together for so long, how was that for you? How did that affect you?
I felt every moment of that, mm-hmm. that those final scenes. Mm-hmm. I felt every moment, you know, Renee Jones and James Reynolds had actually been together before. Renee played a character called Nikki Wade, who was was Abe's secretary,
mm-hmm.
years ago.
Right.
I think maybe the third or fourth year I was on the show, and she was on for about a year or so,
mm-hmm.
at that point. And I think that was before Renee went on and did L.A. Law shortly after that.
Mm-hmm.
So we had been together doing that show, and then when the possibility of Renee becoming Lexi came up, I thought, "Oh, this is great."
Yeah.
And so we had probably one of the most consistent relationships in all of daytime television,
mm-hmm.
with all of its ups and downs and bumps and, you know, all the difficulties that you have on daytime TV. But as a person, we couldn't have melded better.
Mm-hmm.
We understood each other, knew how each other worked, got each other in all those ways. So, and my wife always called Renee her sister wife, actually, because it just worked very, very well.
Yeah,
it could not have worked better, and. So it was very difficult. It was very difficult when she left, and I knew why she was leaving, and I mm-hmm. absolutely supported her, and as I do to this day. And she's living a wonderful life and having a great time.
I bet.
So, as a person who works with someone, as you guys do, you guys would be in tears if either one left.
Yeah.
So that was. You know, that was tough. But knowing that the character was going to move on, and this was another thing that Abe was going to survive,
mm-hmm.
and move through, that was important too.
Yeah.
To show that he had this strength, and he had a son that he had to survive for.
Yeah. Sure.
Have you had a favorite storyline over the course of the 35 years?
That's one of the hardest questions I have to answer. Is do I have a favorite storyline? I don't. I have a lot of favorite storylines.
Yeah.
There are many of them. You know, one that always comes to mind, of course, is finding out that Abe had Brandon as his son.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
And
Abe seems to have, like, a lot of kids he didn't know.
Abe's got children.
Abe has not been as quiet as everybody thinks. Abe has not been a silent man over the years. He's been very active human being, as he should be. That was probably one of them. And you know, finding out that that he had this really strong and deep relationship with Faye, and we talked about Nicole Walker, mm-hmm. earlier, and how important Ari and I feel that relationship is.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing with his relationship with Faye, which was an early deeply loving and caring relationship,
mm-hmm.
and Valerie Wildman, who's wonderful and a close friend, and mm-hmm. was beautiful as Faye, and I thought that story was fantastic, and finding out about Brandon and how close and all those different colors that come into this relationship with Brandon and feeling he'd been abandoned and all of that. That was wonderful. But there are so many others. You know, with Lexi and taking Isaac from Bo. The first Valerie Grant and being involved while working on the Salem Strangler story, that first story always holds a special spot for me. So it goes on
and on.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
I've got five bullets in. Abe's got five bullets in his head. I sometimes get Abe and I confused. But I don't have five bullets in my head. But he still has five bullets in his head. He's been shot that many times his head.
Right.
He has. Right. And still survives.
Scott's tape under here.
Yeah.
That's what's holding it together.
Well, Abe has been shot a lot. I remember also when they did the Salem serial killer back in like 2003. Abe was the first one and was shot.
First one, yes.
Yep. And was shot then.
Yes, and my wife announced me dead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I remember during that time, that was another moment for me as a fan. And probably the first time I actually went online, because online was just, you know, brand new then, to see what was happening, because so many major characters were getting killed off the show. Really? And I started wondering, oh my God, are they bringing these people back? What was it for you? Did you have that
we
moment
all
of like,
that.
What's happening?
Everybody was on the same page.
Everybody was the same place. Yeah, yeah. No, we didn't know. We didn't know. We were... You know, that was, I mean, there were 10 of us, I think, in all.
Yeah.
And, no, we didn't know. I mean, we essentially moved on.
Yeah.
Most
and
then of us.
You hear that doorbell ring and those stack of scripts come back, and you're like, oh,
and
I
then
guess,
we go,
I guess we're
wow,
back.
Wow. Well, there was a phone call to precede that said, hey, guess what? You know, we're going to bring you guys back. And but that didn't happen for months.
Yeah.
And weeks. And so we were all left. You know, we were out there, and we thought it was an interesting way for the story to turn.
It was very interesting.
Of course, it was another plot by Stefano.
Oh, Stefano!
That's Stefano.
Before we run out of time, because we have about 10 minutes left.
Oh,
I know it goes by quickly.
Yeah, it does.
A lot of fans want to know. They've been in the chat and chatting away, and they want to know, without giving anything away, as you can't do, and so
we can't.
Any tidbits or look as to what will happen with Abe moving forward?
A lot.
Yeah.
Is all I can tell you. I think everybody knows by now that we shoot well ahead of time.
Well, like 6 months now.
Yeah. We're very far ahead. So actually, even some of the things that everybody's seeing now, I've forgotten about.
You're like, oh, that did
I don't
happen.
Remember. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. I remember that happened. Yeah, I see that. So even if I said something, I could be wrong.
Yeah.
But I do know that there's a lot that's going to go on.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of reasons for everybody to still stay tuned.
Yes.
That Abe is going to be involved, and which is a good thing. And I think you're going to see some very interesting things.
Oh, good.
Yeah, in the next few months.
Well, you will have to come back in and talk about them.
I am thrilled to do it. I didn't know the time had gone so fast.
I know.
So, I would have been much more succinct in my in my answers.
Listen, people have been enjoying it so far. I'm gonna trying to scroll through.
I've got one while you look. You had mentioned that the two things that you knew about Days of Our Lives were McDonald Carey's voice and the hourglass. Lisa Mims wants to know what it was like working with Francis and Mac.
Oh my goodness. Highlights of my life.
Mm-hmm.
Highlights of my life. Both are extraordinary people. I was lucky enough to work with legends early in my career.
Yes.
You know, I mentioned the series I did with Vincent Price. I did a movie with James Stewart. I obviously worked on Days of Our Lives with Matt Carey and Francis Reed. And the characteristic that they all shared was generosity. They were all very, very generous to this very young actor who came in and shared the stage with them. Mm-hmm. And it was extraordinary. And I, you know, next time we talk, I'll tell you some stories that Mac told me about old Hollywood and all of that. And I watch old Westerns. I love Westerns. Mm-hmm. So I watch old Westerns, and I see Francis Reed pop up on all kinds of old Westerns, and John Clark and Matt Carey, and it's wonderful.
Yeah. One fan wanted to know, the Nickel City Scratcher wanted to know.
Nickel City Scratcher?
Yeah.
I don't think I'm going to investigate that.
They ask, what did you think about Abe going blind in 2004?
Oh, you know, Abe went blind twice.
Yeah.
He went blind twice.
Abe.
Yeah, he did. I know. It's
bullets in his head.
Bullets blind. In multiple his head. Multiple children. Blind. Yeah, multiple children. This guy is a very complicated
He's
man.
He's lived a lot of life that
Abe. Yes, he has. I loved it. I loved it. Anytime you're challenged as an actor, anytime you can, you get something that really makes you go, okay, well, how am I going to make this work, and how am I going to do this and make the audience believe it? That is a thrill.
Yeah.
And yeah. I loved both times actually that mm-hmm. I went blind. I the first time I had a little more warning about and knew you know, so I could figure it out. The second time I'd already done it, so.
They were just like, yeah. He's blind yeah. again. And he's you're blind. Like, well, all right.
Cool. I know how to do this.
Very nice. Willa Sargent, who has been a fan for 51 years. I think I told you about her before we started. She just wants a hello. So if you want to look in that camera right there and Willa, say hello to Willa.
Willa, hello. How are you? Thank you so much for watching for 51 years.
Yes.
That is extraordinary.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, there are things you could tell me about the show. And I actually wouldn't mind hearing about it. I find out things about the show from fans like you, Willa, all the time.
Yeah.
And it actually helps. It really does. It helps me, and it helps my character. And we share that on stage. One of the great things about Vanessa when she came on the show is wanting to know about the history, not only of Valerie Grant, but of Abe and Valerie and the show.
Mm-hmm.
And you have no idea how helpful that is to actors.
Oh,
thank
yeah.
you.
Is there a historian at Days of Our Lives who helps jog memories or remember
There's
all the...
There's a collective history. There's a collective history. And I've actually, and Vanessa coming on the show and asking certain questions, I've reached out to fans, and those of you know who you are. I won't say your name just in case you don't want me to. But I actually reached out to fans that I didn't know personally at the time, but I knew of them and knew how to get in touch with them so that they could help me help her. And it's great to hear those things and know those things.
Yeah, because fans remember
everything. Yes.
Even us here, sometimes we forget things, and so we call it out to the fans, and then we look down and we have our answers.
God forbid we make a mistake too.
Oh gosh, we will be corrected instantly.
Well, I'm going to ask a question, so the next time you can give me the answer here. This is my understanding. I'm not sure I'm right, mm-hmm. but I understand Francis Reed didn't do the pilot, and I wonder who did do the pilot. Does anybody know who that person was? I mean, I cannot imagine anyone else as
the role of Alice?
As Alice Horton, than Francis Reed, but my understanding is that Francis was not the person who did the pilot, so I'm very curious about who that person
I just
was
watched before. The pilot recently, too.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I went
because
to...
Because it's on YouTube.
I went
it?
To,
it is on YouTube.
It is on YouTube, but yes.
Everything is on YouTube.
Well, that probably answered my question.
I went to Paley Center, and you can watch old episodes.
Oh,
and I wanted to see the first one, and it revolves mostly around Julie shoplifting.
Yeah. But Francis is in that
and
one.
And was that Susan? Was
I
that
don't
Susan?
Remember.
It was Julie Susan at that time?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's great.
Isn't well, that great. That's also amazing.
Yeah, who I've got to tell you was, when I began, and she and Bill remain two of my favorite people on the show. And, you know, I just, it's great. We had a chance to get together for dinner away from the show, actually away from LA, which is really kind of special sometimes, how you meet people you see every day.
Yeah.
Then you're a couple thousand miles away, and then, let's have dinner. Let's sit down and do this.
What other co-stars, if any, do you spend time with outside of work?
Well, I spent time with a number, if I started listing them. But, Josh Taylor and I talk a lot. We both share the same political opinions, so we
I'm sure there's been a lot of discussions.
A lot of that, and we talk a lot. Charles Shaughnessy, we're close. There are a great number of people. Ari, of course, and just a large number of people. And once I start naming names, I feel bad. I shouldn't have named one.
Right.
Because when you get back to set, they're going to say,
Brian DiTillo and I are in the same fantasy basketball league that I've been running for over 20 years. So, there are a lot of people that I see outside of the set.
Very nice.
You were right. We're already getting confirmation. Mary Jackson played Alice in the unaired pilot.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The unaired pilot.
That's according.
Very interesting.
Yep.
And to John.
And look how quick that was.
That was very quick. Yes. It is. That's very, very interesting. Wow.
Well, we have to wrap up, unfortunately. But, James, it has been a pleasure.
A pleasure.
Thank you for coming in and share your thoughts on the show. And, I feel like we need more time to, go over...
I'm all for it.
Everything.
Let's do it.
So you're welcome back anytime.
Yes. So I will continue to bug you.
Sooner than last time.
Yes.
I promise.
Yes, I promise. And we'll have you in. And then maybe then you can talk about all the great things that are happening with Abe and Theo and Valerie,
and I almost gave away story for a minute.
And, he was so close.
Cut.
We won't do that.
No. Well, thank you guys so much for tuning in. I am your host, Tony Moore. You can find me on all social media platforms at Lounging with Tony or my website, loungingwithtony.com. Matthew, where can they find you?
You can find me on Instagram and Twitter at Matthew E. Paine.
Now, and James, you are active on social media.
I do. I tweet. My wife actually runs our Instagram account, as you know.
Yes.
She's very active on that, more than I am. But yes, you can tweet me James. I don't even remember my Twitter. This is terrible.
I'm looking.
What is it?
Even I forgot.
J. Reynolds James.
That's right. With a cap on the J and the James.
Yes.
So J. Reynolds at James. J. Reynolds James. And I look forward to seeing everybody on Twitter.
And what about
I do
Instagram?
Look at everybody. That's James and Lisa Reynolds. James and Lisa Reynolds. Yes.
That's Lisa and James.
You pop right up when they start the search. You pop right up.
But she's very good at it.
Yes. Yes.
Lisa's very, very good at it. She will respond and be on top of it. I'm fairly good at it.
Do you enjoy social media?
I do, actually. Yeah, I do. I really do enjoy it. I have not yet invested myself in Facebook, but that day will come.
Yes.
It will come.
Well, thank you again, guys, for tuning in live. And don't forget, at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we will be giving you a full recap of this week's episodes of Days of Our Lives right here on AFTERBUZZ TV. You don't want to miss it. Stay tuned, and we'll see you guys next week.
Thank you.
See you soon.
Good night.
Bye-bye.
Executive
producer Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff. We would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Tyler and Sal. We didn't talk about Sal.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.